this is the worst part. I just want to thank you all for coming today. Grace and peace with you all. And I just hope that this time is as blessing as it was to me, as it is to you. So let me start out with a word of prayer, and then we'll get into the text. Father, we thank you so much for this day. We thank you so much for your grace. We thank you so much for your love and the fact that we are able to be here. But I just pray that you bless this time, bless my words, let your words speak through me. Let me just be a vessel. Let me just be the man who you prepared me to be for today. And I thank you for these men and for this time. I pray these things in Jesus' holy name. Amen. So Paul has an argument here in Romans 3, 1 through 8, that there was a little struggle between the Jews and the Gentiles, that the Jews were like, well, I'm better than the Gentiles. And the Gentiles were like, whoa, wait a second. Like, something's going on here. So I have a story in my personal life that I myself went through. I was about 21 or 22, and I was driving my dad's car. I had no car at the time. I had just crashed my car. And so my dad was gracious enough to give me his car to drive. So I'm driving to a party, and this party includes alcohol. And we all know what happens when you're at a party with alcohol. And so I'm driving up, I have my little stash of alcohol in the back. And in order to get there, it's a gated community. So you have to go through a gate, you have to push a button, the gate rises, the gate falls, go, do your thing, so be it. So I went in, went to the party, drank a lot, and it was pretty late. I don't even know what time it was. I don't even care what time it was. So my one friend comes up to me and he goes, Matt, you look a little funky. And I was just like, oh, great. Like, no big deal. And he's like, you probably should go home. It's late. It's winter. It's probably getting icy out. And I was just like, you know what? That's a good idea. I should drive home drunk. And so driving down the road, trying to make ends meet, trying to just do my thing. And so I get to this gate, and I drive up to it, and I'm like, why isn't the gate not opening? Why is this piece of plastic not going up? And I was like, oh, right, I have to press the button for the gate to open. So I back my car up, and for some reason, someone placed a giant yellow pillar full of cement just right behind my car. And I back up my car, bam, right into the pole, and I was just like, who put that there? Was that there before? And in my drunkenness, I pull the car out, and as I'm pulling the car away, I hear, and I was like, oh, I can buff that out, I can wash it, but no big deal. Push the button, the gate rises, the gate falls, drive home. It's about a 3-mile drive, probably took me like 2 hours to get there, I don't know, but I get to this one point where the sidewalk ends, right before my development, and it's a double lane road. And you know, there's a lot of space in the road. There's a lot of area to go. And so I somehow drive my car up onto the curb and down off the curb. And I was like, oh, there's a bump in the road. And so continue on, make it home safe. The next day I wake up, I have to go to work, and I'm late. I had the worst hangover of my life. Don't get drunk, ever. Biblical. And so I wake up, and my mom and dad were asleep. And I say, oh my gosh, I have to be to work. The worst headache of my life. I'm hungover. I don't like this already. Get into my dad's car, turn it on, back up, and I'm like, what's that loud noise? And like the car's bumping up and down, and not because of my stereo, because of the flat tire that I have. And I was just like, someone slashed my tire. Somebody was dumb enough to slash my tire. And I get out and I look, and I was like, someone hit my car too in the middle of the night. Like, really? Like, no one left me a note. No one told me anything. And so my mom's like, all right, I'll take you to work. I get to work, worst day of my life. Get back home, and my dad goes, Matt, you were drunk last night, right? And I was like, no, I wasn't drunk. And he was like, first of all, I could smell it in your room. And I was like, no, I wasn't drunk. I wasn't drinking. He was like, you had a headache this morning, right? And I was just like, no. But eventually, I ended up confessing that I was drunk. But my father had the right to be angry at me because of what I had done to his car. And my dad still, for some reason, let me drive his car. He still loved me, and he still called me his son. And I was like, this is not fair. Like, this doesn't make sense. And this is what Paul's getting at here in Romans 3, 1 through 8, that even though I, my father's son, crashed his car, he still chose to love me. He still chose to have grace over me. Why? Because I'm his son. And he wants to love me. I came from his seed. My dad still chooses to love me. My dad still loves me because my dad's grace abounded. So let me get into the text. And I'll read you Romans 3, 1 through 8. Paul starts out here. Then what advantage has the Jew? Or what is the value of circumcision? Much in every way. To begin with, the Jews were entrusted with the oracles of God. What if some were unfaithful? Does their faithfulness nullify the faithfulness of God? By no means. Let God be true, though everyone were a liar, as it is written, that you may be justified in your words and prevail when you are judged. But if our unrighteousness serves to show the righteousness of God, what shall we say? That God is unrighteous to inflict wrath on us? I speak in a human way. By no means. For then, how could God judge the world? But if through my lie, God's truth abounds to his glory, why am I still being condemned as a sinner? And why not do evil that good may come? As some people slanderously charge us with saying, their condemnation is just. So like I said, there's a little quarrel between the Jews and the Gentiles here. And Paul's addressing this situation because earlier in chapter 2, Paul is talking about circumcision and how if you don't act like you're circumcised, then your circumcision is nullified. Because circumcision of the flesh means nothing. It's like being a man and not acting like a man. It's like being a Christian and not acting like a Christian. Makes sense? And so Paul is addressing this to the Jews. And there probably were some Gentiles in the area as Paul was speaking. And as I was preparing this, I was like, so what are these oracles? What is the oracles? And I did some research, and oracles in the Greek means logion. And in the Hebrew it means logos, which is word, an important word or saying. And so Paul is saying to the Jews, yes, you have an advantage. Yes, you have the advantage. Why? Because you were circumcised and God entrusted you with the oracles. Why? Because the Jews were the ones that were chosen. The Jews are God's chosen people. So Paul is saying right here, so in verse 1, what is the value of circumcision? Because he's competing with what he had said in chapter 2, that if you're circumcised, then pretty much act like you're circumcised. Don't be circumcised and then just go off sinning because you can sin for sin's sake. Be righteous because your heart is circumcised. It's not because circumcision of the flesh. It's because of your heart. So the Jews were entrusted with the oracles of God. And this is where my first point comes in. I have 3 points. We are entrusted with God's words. We as Christians are entrusted with God's words. So as we saw in verses 1 through 8, the Jews were unrighteous, and God's grace abounds through all things. Though the Jews were unrighteous, God's grace abounds through all things. And we as Christians, we need to do something about this. We need to do something about the fact that we as mature Christians are entrusted with the oracles of God. We have already heard God's word. We have already been through church. We've sat through and hear and heard pastors preach. We've heard great sermons. We've heard John Piper, Mark Driscoll, Andy Stanley. We've heard all these guys speaking all these things. So do something about it. Don't just sit there and act like a sinner all the time. Do something about it. Why? Because God's grace abounds. Righteousness abounds through all things. Why? Because God chooses to. God doesn't do it because he has to. God chooses for his righteousness to abound. To about circumcision of the flesh. I mean, it's about circumcision of the heart, not the flesh. Like I said, the Jews were circumcised, yes, by the flesh, but it was about their heart. God doesn't care about your flesh. God cares about what's inside your heart. In verse 3, Paul says, "What if some were unfaithful? Does their faithfulness nullify the faithfulness of God? By no means." There's an exclamation point right there. By no means. Paul is addressing this and saying, listen, no. Our faithfulness does not nullify the faithfulness of God. Why? Because God's grace abounds. God promised us to save us. God promised all these promises that he promised in the Old Testament, in the oracles that the Jews already knew. So if I'm unfaithful, God is not faithless. So like I said, guys, act like a righteous Christian. Don't wake up every day and just go, well, I want to sin today. I hope that's not what you guys do. I hope you guys don't wake up and go, I want to sin today. I hope, as a mature Christian, you want to wake up and be like, you know what? I'm going to pick up my cross, and I'm going to carry it no matter how hard it is. Why? Because Christ died on the cross, the most horrible death you could imagine. Like, his guts were falling out. He was dying to himself. Do something about this, guys. Like, don't just sit around saying, well, I'm in Bible class every day, so I'm righteous. No. God doesn't care about what knowledge you have. God cares about the heart. God didn't care about the Jews' flesh being circumcised. I keep on saying this word, righteousness. What does it mean? What does it mean? In the Greek, it is dikaios. And righteous means what is right. So when God's grace abounds, when his righteousness abounds, that's the right thing to do. Whatever God does is right. God cannot do anything that is wrong. We should never sin for sin's sake, like I said. This is where I get my second point. Let me read first, and then I'll state my point. In verse 4, let God be true, though everyone were a liar, as it is written. And this is from Psalm 51, 1. And we can remember that this psalm is the David that psalm wrote because of what he did with Bathsheba. We all remember that Bathsheba committed adultery with David, and that David committed adultery with her. And he was so distraught, he was so just groaning that he had committed this adultery with her. And David says, you should just take my life. I don't deserve to live. And that's what Paul says. Like, I do not deserve to live. Because we can look at Paul's life and see he what? He blasphemed Christians. He didn't do any justifiable thing. He was walking around betraying Christ. And look, he writes this passage in Romans. He writes the whole book of Romans. He writes so many other books too. God's grace abounds through all things. No matter what. Why? Because he promised it to us. He promised it to us in the Old Testament. God chooses to give us grace. Why? Because he loves us. I'm going to go really slow through this text because it's really hard. This is really hard. And David says, that you may be justified in your words and prevail when you are judged. So he had just committed this adultery with Bathsheba. And he's just like, I am such a horrible, horrible person. And God pretty much said through David, you'll be justified in your words, and you'll prevail when you are judged. Through the Jews' unrighteousness, God's grace abounds through all things. Why? Because he chooses to. I can't say this enough. God's grace abounds through all things. God's grace abounded to David, even though he committed adultery with her. God's grace abounds even though we commit adultery, even though we sin, even though we lie, even though we do things that we don't want to do, but we still do it. We get up every day and we have pride, we have lust, we steal, we get drunk. But God still loves us. Like, that does not make sense. And Paul gets into it in the latter verses of this chapter. In verse 5, Paul says, but if our unrighteousness serves to show the righteousness of God, what shall we say? That God is unrighteous to inflict wrath on us? I speak in a human way. By no means! Why? Because God is always righteous. God chooses to have grace on us. Why? Like I said, because he loves us. My dad chose to love me. My dad chose to still give me the car and to drive it. Why? Because my father loves me. My father in heaven loves me, no matter what I do, because he chooses us. He chose you. He chose the Jews. God still loved the Jews, even though they were unrighteous. God still loves them. God still loves us. And this is why Paul says, I speak in a human way. Because in human terms, you would say, all right, well, you sinned, so go over there. Like, your child stole money out of your wallet. And you're going to be like, all right, you're grounded. Like, you just did something wrong. God does not inflict wrath on us. God's not up there in heaven going, all right, so this city was bad, and so I'm going to send Hurricane Katrina this way. And LA, you guys are a blasphemous city, so I'm going to send an earthquake, and I'm going to send a tsunami, and I'm going to do this. God's not some magician up in heaven going, all right, you guys are bad. It says in Timothy, God cannot do anything that is bad. God only does good. It is because of our sin that we have to live with the condemnation. We have to deal with the guilt and corruption that Adam dealt with. We inherit that guilt and corruption. We inherit that, like it says in Genesis. The earth is under sin. But God still loves us, no matter what. That's why Paul says, I speak in a human way. Like, this doesn't make sense. But it still does. I love God. Like, he loves us because he chose to. I'm going to pick up in the other half of verse 5. No, I'm sorry, in verse 7. But if through my lie, God's truth abounds to his glory, why am I still being condemned as a sinner? And why not do evil that good may come? As some people slanderously charge us with saying, their condemnation is just. And I keep on saying this word grace. What does it mean? How do we understand this? Like, what are we doing? And grace in the Greek is charis. And it's the state of kindness and favor towards someone. That's what God does to us. He shows favor and kindness towards us. Why? Because he chooses to. God chooses to give us grace. Through our unrighteousness, God's grace abounds through all things, always, always, always. Why? Because he promised it to us. God doesn't make a promise and then goes back on it. He keeps a promise always. God cannot change. God cannot gain nor lack knowledge. And I say that word grace with power. Why? Because grace is what saves us. And this brings up a very big theological word. And I'm going to explain it to you guys. It's antinomianism. This is a term coined by Martin Luther from the Greek. Antinomos, which means against law. So this means that we are saved by faith, not by grace. Yes, we are saved by grace. We are saved by faith. We are saved by grace through faith. God has grace over us, and then through our faith, we are saved. So yes, I hope that made sense. We are saved by grace through faith. This is my third point. We are to die to righteousness, not to sin. And this is where Paul is speaking in verse 7 to 8, that God's truth abounds to his glory. So, even though we are unrighteous, God's grace still abounds. In Romans 6, Paul speaks of, we are blasphemers, we are drunkards, we are adulterers. We do not want to serve God. We do not want to love God. We do not want to have anything with God. But he still loves us. Why? Because God's grace abounds through all things. God will always have grace on us. Why? Because we are his children. Even though the Jews were unrighteous, God's grace abounded. Always. I can still be a slave to sin and still be saved, but as a mature Christian, I want to be saved by righteousness. I want to be saved through my righteousness. Let me explain that a little bit more. If I'm righteous, God will save me. If I'm a sinner and live in sin, God still saves me. But if I commit myself to carry my cross every day, God will still love me. If I fall on my face and commit adultery and steal and corrupt the world, God's still going to love me. Why? Because God chooses to. We were like, well, then God, why? There's things that we should not ask God. Paul says this in Romans. There are things that we should not just know. The mysteries of God we do not know. A lot of the Jews thought that this was cheap grace. This isn't cheap grace. This is not cheap grace. This is the best grace we could ever have. Why? Because I'm still a sinner. I hate God some days, but God still loves me. One of my children one day might steal my wallet. One of my children one day might steal my car. You know what? I'm going to get very angry. But I still have to love them because they're my children. God does not hate the sinner. God hates the sin problem that we have. God cannot hate his children. But then, Matt, what about election? That's a question that we ask that is not answered because God does things for his glory. Through our unrighteousness, God's grace abounds through all things. And Paul's saying in the latter part of the verse, why am I still being condemned as a sinner? So God gives me grace. Why am I still being condemned? And through my study of this, I believe we need to understand this a little bit, that when Adam and Eve ate the fruit from the tree of good and evil, they had knowledge of good and evil. So in order for us to understand good, we have to understand evil. So if God's righteousness was not bestowed on us, if God's righteousness didn't abound, we wouldn't know what was good. We wouldn't know what was bad. So by God having grace over us, we understand that His glory is so much better than what the world has to offer. Because God is perfect. God is good. God is great. God's grace abounds through all things. Why? Because He chooses to. He doesn't have to. He didn't have to make us. He didn't have to put us in heaven. He didn't have to do anything. He was content with where He was in heaven. But God chose to make us. God doesn't owe us anything, guys. Paul picks up in 8 and says, "Why not do evil so that good may come? And some slanderously charge us with saying, their condemnation is just." Their condemnation is just because God's grace is just. If we choose to be a slave to sin, we're going to be a slave to sin. If I choose to do good, I'm going to be a slave to good. I'm going to be a slave to righteousness. And this is really hard. This part is really hard. Because we can't understand why God does what He does. Like, how can I be a slave to sin and God still loves me? And God still wants me to go to heaven? Why? Because the atonement happened. And we receive that blood, just like they did back in Passover. They took the blood of the lamb and they put it over the doorpost. The blood of Jesus Christ is now over our doorpost. And God passes over us. Why? Because He chooses to. He doesn't have to. He chooses to. This is such a beautiful thing. Like, Paul was speaking this, and this probably was really hard for a lot of these people. But if I can just help you guys understand one thing, that God loves us no matter what. God's grace abounds through all things. Even though the Jews were unrighteous, God's grace still abounded. Why? Because He chose to. I can't say it enough. Through the Jews' unrighteousness, God's grace abounded through all things. Even though they were quarreling about, well, I'm circumcised, so I'm great. No, your flesh doesn't get you saved. It's the heart. It's what's in your heart. And that's why I'm going to challenge you guys and say this. Get up off your butts and do something. Act like a Christian. Act like a righteous man. Don't go out into the world and blaspheme God. Yes, God will still love you. Yes, God will save you. But give God a good name. Give God a glorious name. I'm sick and tired of hearing people, oh, God and this. Like, no, like, I'm sick and tired of people blaspheming God, saying His name in an unrighteous way. And they go to a Bible college. Act like a Christian. God is greater than this. Like, don't just sin for sin's sake. Be a slave to righteousness. Understand that God's grace abounds. God loves you guys. All right? Like, that's all I want you to understand. Let me close with prayer. Father, thank you so much for this time, and I just pray that we can all absorb what you have spoken through me. I just pray that as these men leave, that you can just pick them up and just love them. I pray all these things in Jesus' holy name. Amen.